Morning, everybody. Thank you for joining us this morning. We're going to give it just a minute or two as people go ahead and trickle in. But thank you guys for joining us again for another installment of Root Cause Matters. Really excited about our conversation today regarding safety and its impact on childhood poverty and what we can do within our communities to hopefully move the needle forward. So again, as always, going to give it here just a minute or two to let people trickle in and we'll get started. But thank you again for joining us. All right. Well, as people join, we'll go ahead and get started. And as always, if there are any questions, please go ahead and feel free to use the Q&A feature. You know, we have the chat box there as well, but much easier for us on the panelist side to be able to track those questions if they come in through the Q&A feature. Excited to be having this conversation this morning. We have a couple incredible guest speakers in Melissa Corbin-Nelson, President and CEO of the United Way of Florida, and Sarah Alfred, the CEO of Big Brothers Big Sisters of Northeast Florida. I've had the fortune of working, connecting with both of these individuals, and they are both not only amazing at what they do, but really experts in this space on community safety. So excited to have them joining us here this morning. As always, kind of want to open up with just a little bit of a brief introduction of where we stand, some data to kind of, you know, contextualize the issue we're going to be talking about today. And then, of course, looking at what we track here at the Florida Chamber of Commerce Foundation. So if we go to one of my opening slides here, I wanted to just show something that I think is relatively stark, but opens up our conversation today to really talk to us at the end of the day about what we're talking about, which is just, you know, the primal idea of safety. So if we jump to that first slide, what it shows here is it shows childhood poverty rates in Leon County on the right-hand side, and it shows homicides that occur within each one of our zip codes in Leon County. And as you can see, unfortunately, the map on the right and the map on the left look very, very similar, just, you know, different heat map colors. On the right in 32304, by childhood poverty percentage, that is the most impoverished zip code within Leon County, with nearly 48% of our children in poverty. And as you can see, 32304, it also has the highest rate of homicide deaths, with 25 occurring within that community over the past few years. What this goes and tells us is that, you know, if you are within those communities, you could be a victim of circumstance. And unfortunately, not cherry picking data, it's not just a reality for our community here in Leon County. If we go to the next slide, I pulled Broward County because it tends to be, you know, one of the communities we talk about a lot. It's also similar within Broward County. If you look again, I know the colors are different, but on the left-hand side, red is the most prevalence of homicides within communities, then yellow, then green. Then orange, then yellow, then green. On the right-hand side, darker blue, the higher prevalence of childhood poverty rates, the lighter, the lower the prevalence. Again, as you can see, those maps are extraordinarily similar, and it happens in nearly every single one of our communities throughout the state of Florida. Unfortunately, as well, homicide isn't the only factor for safety that we look at, and it isn't the only factor that's more prevalent within our low-income communities. Jump to the next slide. Very interesting conversation that we've been having recently is what type of crime afflicts individuals within the communities that they grow up in. And I think for some, there is this misnomer that yes, violent crime happens within our low-income communities, but property crime or economically driven crime tends to target individuals within higher income communities. It may come from individuals throughout a community, but somebody would target breaking into a home, theft, or burglary within high income communities. And again, that's just not true anywhere in the nation. In fact, almost every single crime you can think of is more prevalent to see within low income communities. And that chart breaks down the prevalence of crime afflicting households at different income levels. And as you can see, it is pretty much just a clear trend downwards. The higher income a household is, the less likely it is to be impacted by crime within that household. If we jump to the next slide as well, I thought this was one of the more interesting things that we came across as we did a little bit of research for not only this webinar, but the work that we do here across the state of Florida. We have a lot of conversations we're going to talk today about youth impacts of not only interacting with crime, but what crime could turn into long-term for an individual. What's interesting to us, and again, maybe not surprising to everybody, is that I would say more lower offense crimes, or at least nonviolent crimes like using marijuana, using other drugs, or selling drugs, it's actually not more prevalent, not really, within our low-income communities or within youths from low-income families. As you see, something like the use of marijuana is relatively similar throughout the entire socioeconomic pipeline. And selling drugs and using other drugs other than marijuana is actually more prevalent within high-income families. But when you start to get towards violent crimes, and I think those crimes that can have a really stark long-term impact on one's growth, one's economic outlook, or being very, very transparent, one's likelihood of interacting with the criminal justice system, things like violence, becoming a gang member, theft at a relatively high, relatively high expense level, or carrying a gun, all of those become exponentially more likely within our low-income communities or within our families that experience socioeconomic challenges. If you go to the next slide, what that ends up turning into is it turns into long-term challenges for those individuals. So if a youth is interacting with the juvenile incarceration system, they are much less likely to graduate from high school. Not only are they much less likely to graduate from high school, they are much more likely to recidivate within their lifetime. And that is through all offenses, violent crimes, property crimes, and any other criminal offense. So what we see here is that we know a few different things. One, crime is typically more prevalent within communities where opportunity does not exist. And that is not any groundbreaking analysis that we're presenting to you today. I think that's something that we all knew, but the data does back that out within all communities around the nation and with our communities here in Florida. Where less opportunity exists, crime is more likely to occur. And if an individual, especially a child, interacts with the criminal justice system or interacts with crime at a younger age, we know that our long-term economic opportunities and outputs are going to be drastically impacted. So that's why I'm excited to open up this conversation and really start with one of our great partners at the United Way of Florida. If we jump to the next slide, I mentioned her a little bit on the front end, but we are really fortunate today to be joined by Melissa Corbin Nelson, the president and CEO of the United Way of Florida. Melissa and I have had an opportunity to work together on a handful of issues since she joined the United Way of Florida formally. Just over a year ago. I hope I got that right, Melissa.
Yes.
But she's long been in the United Way family, coming from the United Way over in the Jacksonville and the Northeast region. So, Melissa, thank you for joining us today. Thank you for kind of helping us set the stage on a conversation, and really excited to talk to you about the United Way's work in the area of safety.
Well, thank you for having me. I'm always happy to interact and collaborate with great partners. I have a fondness for the chamber at the local level and the state level, because I know the chamber does such amazing work. And so I'm just happy to be able to be here and talk with you a little bit about the work that we do at 211 and how that impacts our local communities and our state and our nation and what we can learn from 211 as a whole.
That's awesome. And for I think everybody on the call, the United Way itself is not going to be a new concept to anybody. It is one of the most recognizable brands in the entire world. I think people do obviously connect the United Way with the great work that is done within communities. But what I think is so interesting is that the United Way does so much work that I think not every single piece of that work gets acknowledged. And I think 211 is part of that conversation. So, Melissa, just give us a brief little background. What is 211? What is the history of 211? How does the United Way interact with that? And what is it doing within our communities?
Well, way back in the 70s and the 80s, early 90s, communities knew that there were a lot of questions and how could we provide answers for those social service questions. A lot of communities had a direct dial line, maybe at their United Way, maybe at their Chamber of Commerce or another nonprofit partner. But those numbers were not accessible. It was not long distance. And then in 2000, the FCC actually designated 211 to work just like 911. And so 211 became something that was accessible across all boundaries. United Way. It was United Way of America at that point in time. Now we're United Way Worldwide, was instrumental in that discussion. And because United Ways were either manning those phones, funding the people manning those phones, organizing the volunteers to man those phones. So of course it made sense that we would take a lead in that. In the Florida area in particular, I'm really happy to share that one of my predecessors was involved in actually creating the policy for the state of Florida that the legislature approved when 211 started, to make sure that everyone answering those phones was qualified, was trained. And the beauty of 211, when you call 211, the information that you receive, and it's a bridge to services, is all vetted. It's accurate, it's true, it's current. In today's world, you might say, well, why don't I just Google that? Well, the information you Google may not be correct, and it's certainly not vetted. It may not be timely, and some of it is actually predatory. So the 211 network makes sure that caring individuals that are trained to assist with the accurate information are the people that pick up the phone and provide that warm connection to services. There, last year in the US, there were about 20 million calls to 211. And imagine if half of those calls had gone to 911 because people were anxious and didn't know where to dial. What a mess that would be. But by calling 211, they get connected to services. And a little over a million of those went into 211 systems here in Florida, all of which are funded, manned, or partnered with United Ways that are on the grounds in the communities.
That is incredible. And, I think there's so much to unpack there. I'm sure we have some younger people on the call today that are saying, what do you mean dialing long distance? Like that's not a thing for many. But what was the concern back in the day?
You can text now and you can go online. You don't even have to dial.
and that's what I love about it. And I think you hit such two perfect notes that I really want to kind of dive into here. One is that it is vital that we have that 911-esque number for services. Because at the end of the day, when you are struggling with a myriad of challenges, nobody may be there for you within your direct life. It is good to know you can reach out to somebody. We think about a moment of, potentially somebody breaking into our home, or we think about having, a loved one have a heart attack in front of us, and all these different issues. And it's terrifying, but we know within that moment there is some sense of comfort that there's a number I can call. There's somebody I can reach out to, and there's expertise on the other end of that line, 911. Well, if you're sitting there at the end of the day going, I don't know if my child's going to be fed today. You're sitting there at the end of the day saying, I may be in an abusive relationship. You're sitting there at the end of the day saying, I am struggling with a mental health challenge that is fully encompassing me. It is good to know that there is a number to reach out to. And I think the second piece is it's good to know that it's from a trusted source. I loved that you hit on the predatory piece of some of this, because I make no mistake here. If you were to Google, I've run out of funds and I need money because I need to feed my child. Payday loans might be one of the first things that comes up on Google. And that is not likely to support your economic growth and your well-being long-term. So I love that, again, it is vetted, it is trusted, and it is looking out for the well-being of the individual. So I love the way you set it up, but dive into a little deeper. Functionally, how is it making our communities more safe?
Well, 211 addresses any issues in social service realm. At United Way, we focus on health, education, and financial stability. That is one of the reasons it's so difficult to explain what United Way does, because that's such a broad range of services. But 211 is for any need like that. It could be that there's a married couple, they've been married for 50 years, and one of them is impacted with Alzheimer's, and the spouse is the caregiver, and they don't know where to turn for just a little bit of respite care, 211. It may be a veteran that is dealing with mental health issues that are not serious enough that they feel like they need to seek counseling, but they need assistance. 211. 211 is for you think your electric is going to be turned off and you've never dealt with it before. You don't know where to go. You're embarrassed to ask for help. 211. 211 is for everything in that bucket. And the beauty of 211 too is that it can pivot and change based on what the calls are coming into the community. During the pandemic, the calls shifted, the resources changed because our providers that we are working with are aware of what's going on in the community, and it's a partnership and an interaction. So 211 is there for all of those types of needs. And how does it keep us safe? Well, you know, imagine you're in a situation where you have a child who you know is having mental health issues. You want to deal with those before it escalates to a situation that there is danger in your community. Same thing with that respite care for a senior. You know, Alzheimer's grows and changes, and sometimes those that we've loved and lived with do become violent. Sometimes if you're overtired, you make the wrong decisions in care. So that's why 211 is so very important. And it's important because it complements not just what your doctor tells you, but what you have in the community as resources. And that's why it's important in that area. It's important because, you know, your example, what if your child is hungry? You can call 211 and find out where's the closest food pantry and what day they're open. If you Google that, you may find a list of 90 food pantries, but none of the information is current. And you need to feed your child today.
And Melissa, it's not hyperbole, your point, that I think it plays in well with our other systems. I can't make this up. One of our colleagues here at the Florida Chamber Foundation is a former 911 dispatcher and literally just messaged me. She's listening in on this call, said, as a dispatcher, I would refer people to United Way's 211 line all the time, because at the end of the day, you know, there's two pieces to it. Awareness. One, everybody needs to know that 211 exists. Mm-hmm. They need to know that there's a safe place to go to. But even when people don't have that awareness, they need to be driven to it, because at the end of the day, you know, 911, the call for 911 may not be to everybody. And you have those two buckets of people who are either calling 911 for a service that may not be a 911 service, or people that aren't calling anybody because they think, well, this doesn't really rise to the level of calling 911, but I am in a desperate situation. So I think getting that awareness out there is vitally important. Another piece that we talk about a lot within the Florida Chamber Foundation, and certainly a lot within the Prosperity Project and our Business Lines for Early Learning, is really insightful data that can be analyzed to make sure we're expending resources in the right way. And we do a lot of that through our zip code level analysis. Talk to me a little bit about how 211's data is analyzed, if that work is done at the zip code level, and how it helps you guys in your efforts to make sure resources are going in the most in need communities.
Well, one of the things that I think is really important to emphasize, by calling 211, you are connected with an individual that's trained to ask questions. So you may call because your electric is about to be turned off. Your electric is going to be turned off because you can't pay your bill, but why can't you pay your bill? What is going on in the household? Understanding there and connecting those dots, learning what the issues are, getting you in touch with a caseworker that will help solve the whole problem and not just a symptom of the problem, is a key of 211. When someone calls, they are going to ask a few key questions, and one of them is your zip code. And clearly, that's so we can connect you with the services that are most close to those that you would need. But also, they may ask if you're a veteran, because you would have access to different assistance as a veteran. They might ask if you are a single mother, again, because there's assistance that would be there. Again, if you're Googling, you're not going to get those questions asked, and you're not going to know that that might be an option. So all of that information is tracked. It's tracked in a community that is running the 211, but then it goes up to the state level. And again, it is going up to the national level, in that we are working with a national database so that we can recognize trends that are happening and address them, and again, pivot to provide the services that are needed. For example, during the pandemic, we quickly recognized that 211 had a spike in calls from seniors. who did not want to leave their house and were food insecure because of that. It wasn't because they necessarily couldn't afford to go to Publix. It was that they didn't know if they were safe to leave their house. So we were able to mobilize deliveries of food to all sorts of groups, those that were at risk with health issues, those that were at risk because of age, those that were at risk to leave their house because they had small infants and no care. And so that's why that data point is such an important one, the zip code, so that we can track that information and begin to identify and work with partners like the chamber to say, okay, this is what we're seeing. What are you seeing?
Yeah, and I love that because at the same time, it not only creates a system that is responsive, but it's also preventative. You know, if you were to open the door to supporting somebody, you know, getting those food services, getting those health services, getting those financial resources, it could prevent an issue from festering into something that is much larger. So again, it can be actionable and responsive in real time, but it can also prevent greater challenges. Obviously, we're the Florida Chamber of Commerce Foundation. We spend nearly every day kind of connecting the dots between the business community, the nonprofit community, and the policy community. But the business community is the backing of our organization. Talk to us a little bit how the business community interacts with 211. What is the role of the business community, and what are you looking for as you expand programs like 211?
Well, I think I'm, it wasn't all that long ago that I talked with the prosperity group at the chamber about Ride United. That's a perfect example. We were able to identify issues during the pandemic, like I just mentioned, where we had concerns in certain populations for food instability that had not been there historically. And we were able to bring in large corporate partners like Lyft, and DoorDash to make those deliveries. So it doesn't have to be a national partner. It could be a local partner. I know in Hernando County, they worked with their local food pantries, their local restaurants to respond. They got the Lyft drivers to do the driving, but the local businesses were providing the resources there. So there's always ample opportunity to right size the assistance or the involvement that our businesses can provide. Obviously, you know, we're United Way. We're always going to be asking for money. But the truth of the matter is the technology that is required for 211 is something that is ever-changing and expensive. But also you see the advantages of funding that. For example, when Hurricane Michael blew into the panhandle, all lines were down, cell lines were down, landlines were down, 911 and the LEOs were overwhelmed. 211 from West Florida in Pensacola rolled over all of the lines, took all the calls, and was backed up by the 211 system across the U.S. because there were so many calls coming in every minute from those families in need. And so when we can recognize what those needs are, you know, for example, in the Hurricane Michael issue, what were the needs of the community? Because you have instant access to the data, we can turn to our business partners or partner organizations and say, this is what we need and this is what we need now. And that's why, the data points are so important.
And I love kind of, you know, getting close to closing it out on that note, this idea that by accessing a resource like 211, we can make our community safer in a lot of respects. We know after storms, crime can grow, and it's because it's crime of need. If you're going hungry, if you're going without, it may drive an individual who hasn't committed a crime before. But if you know you have a resource you can rely on, it can allow a safety or a community to be more safe in those times of crisis. And I love that it is such a connected network that you can back one another up across the country. So, you know, as we close out, I would love to just get some final thoughts. You know, what would you want business leaders to know, nonprofit leaders to know, policy leaders to know as we move forward about 211 and all the great work the United Way does to make our community safer, and how can they help?
Well, I think that in Florida, we need to elevate the discussion of 211. 211, I like to refer to it a little bit as the Wild West. When the FCC made 211 available, it was executed different in different communities and in different states. You will see some states where 211 is all centrally run through one provider and it's government funded. That's not what we see in the state of Florida. However, I will tell you our current legislature and government is beginning to, beginning to really understand the value of 211. And there was an appropriation in the budget this past year to fund a state director for the organization that oversees the 211 network, and that's called FLARES, or Florida Association of Information Referral Services. But that funding, this is the first time we've seen that funding, and it's a great way to bring everyone together. But I think it's really important. I think in Florida, we don't want it to be just funded and run through a government entity. What we want is this partnership, this ability to be nimble, the ability to drive locally in our communities, what our communities need. And so it's really important for one, us to elevate the conversation of 211, understand the value of it, to bring in business partners that are able to say, wow, now I understand what 211 does. How do we make it better? When I say United Way's fund, partner, or run 211s across the state, we are not receiving tremendous government funding like they are in other states. So we're raising those funds, we are finding the partners, and it is a large undertaking. So, you know, gathering that support is very important, having advocates in Tallahassee that say, gosh, you know, we did not realize the value of 211, and asking for support there, as well as supporting your local United Way and asking how to be involved and make a difference with your 211. And then also, you know, understanding when there is something in the community that's really going to drive those calls and drive those needs, how do we respond promptly? So that's what I would say. The slide that's up now shows you that if you go to United Way of Florida website, all you have to do is put in your zip code to know how to contact your United Way. We are all connected as a network, but we are all individual to our communities. We say we're global, but hyper-local. So you can use my website to get through to your local United Way and learn more about the 211 that's serving your community and how large the community is that your 211 serves.
Thank you so much, Melissa. I really appreciate it. Valuable conversation this morning. Appreciate 211 and all the good work the United Ways of Florida do across our state. And looking forward to staying connected with you and your team as we move forward with all of our work to come. So thank you for joining us this morning, and I hope you have a great rest of your day.
Well, thank you so much for having me. I appreciate it, and enjoying everything that you're doing. Looking forward to hearing the next speaker.
Awesome. Well, I am too, and really lucky here to be joined by the president and CEO of the Big Brothers Big Sister Northeast Florida. I always want to say Northwest. I don't know why, but Sarah Alfred. Sarah, thank you for joining us. I know you guys are doing a ton of work over there in the Jacksonville area. I know we've had an opportunity to connect, and you had an opportunity to present at the Prosperity Summit, but I really wanted you to bring it to our webinar series as well. The work you guys are doing to help make our community safer. And I think really this thought of how Big Brothers Big Sisters and other mentorship programs generally can help really bring safety and security to a community. So thank you for joining us.
Yeah, thank you for having me. It's always a pleasure to get to join this group and be here talking about ways that we can help make sure that Florida is reaching its full potential and having all the prosperity we hope for. So I'm going to kick off a little bit of a presentation, and I know I have some slides available, and they'll probably get those queued up for me here, but I always love to level set because there's not always a very clear and overt linkage between safety and programs like Big Brothers Big Sisters, an organization like mine who seeks to create one-to-one mentoring relationships that really help young people reach their full potential. So I always like to backtrack just real quick and talk about safety in general. So you can do the next slide. And it seems pretty standard, but if you go to the next slide, I just have up here the definition of safety. And I think it's important to think about this because we want to think about safety in the forms of danger, risk, and injury, but it's always really important to acknowledge, just as Kyle led off with, just as Melissa spoke, there's not just physiological safety, there's psychological safety. And we know as humans, one of our most basic thing is to ensure that we are physiologically safe. So they talked a lot about food insecurity, housing insecurity, violence in the area. All of those things are definitely parts of what makes sure and what drives us as humans in our day-to-day life. Go to the next slide, please. But when you think about the basic needs, there is a hierarchy of all of those things. And you can see at that bottom level, the thing that most of us even subconsciously spend the vast majority of our energy on is those physiological existence needs, those survival needs. And so if you look at that, you have to recognize it's important that those things get taken care of at that ground level before you can start to sense safety and security as a psychological feeling, before you can start to feel love and belonging, before you can go into that space of self-esteem and self-actualization. I think everyone desires self-actualization. Everybody wants to reach their highest potential. Everyone wants to have success for themselves, for the community. And it's often disrupted by failure to meet some of these lower levels, especially at that basic survivor level and at that psychological level. And so when you talk about these disparities, those are extra elevated and heightened when you have communities that have economic disparities, health and wellness disparities, and academic achievement disparities. And we know that people want to experience order. They want to have predictability. They want to have control in their lives. And that is often fulfilled by family and community. So if you go to the next slide. I love that the chamber focuses on quality of life as a huge pillar for the 2030 blueprint. It's so important because it highlights, again, those social environments, the conditions of the community, actual and perceived safety, and shows that those are so fundamental for not only satisfaction for the people who are existing here in our communities today, but how we're attracting that talent, how we're attracting that future investment in our Florida communities. Love and belonging are that next level of need, and they signify an emotional need for personal relationships. The need for love and belonging is inherent in all of us, but important to understand is it's particularly important for children and adolescents who still depend on their relationships with those in their lives to ensure those physiological needs. So youth are dependent on parents and caregivers for food, shelter, safety, connection, and all of that comes from that relationship. So for young people, that hierarchy is kind of flip-flopped in some ways. And so we see that's why sometimes youth are making choices, why there's sometimes correlation with gang involvement or justice involvement with youth that are in poverty, because there are youth that are looking for relationships to help secure some of those fundamental needs in their life. If you go on to the next. And that just kind of highlights all of those pieces, and then flip to the next for me one more time. We know as a community, we have some economic struggle and continued need. We have a large portion of our Florida community and a disproportionate amount of economic hardship in our prosperity zip codes, struggling to solve those basic needs and provide that sense of safety. We have more single parent led households or two parent families where both parents are working than any other time in the history of our nation and our state. And so when the family unit is otherwise taxed because there's only one parent figure in the home, or there's two, but they're both working nonstop, we find an absence of structure and safety usually forged by that family. And so people start to look out into the community for those types of things. Again, this void is disproportionate in some of our neighborhoods, especially in inequity of quality of situations, and it causes significant and disproportionate disruptions for the young people, especially amongst youth who have challenged households. So school environments can create positive structure and both senses of physiological and emotional safety, but when the school day is done and more of our youth have parents working and they're maybe unavailable for after school time, That's where programs like Big Brothers Big Sisters, other mentoring organizations, other club sites like Boys and Girls Clubs, police athletic things, league, places like that become centers and pillars in our community, so that young people can go to for not only a physiological safety, but start to experience that self-awareness, that psychological and self-actualization type of safety. So if you go on to the next slide. Though our work is not identical in all approaches, and this one you're gonna have to click through a few times, I apologize for that. What is common is that all of the programs that are offered in our community are all dynamic. We are working to remove youth from unsafe or unstructured circumstances. We want to create these growth-based opportunities through exposure and provide interactions with caring individuals, caring components of our community in a constructive way. Specifically at Big Brothers Big Sisters, the breadth and intentionality of our mentoring programs allows our organization to be responsive and adaptive to the needs of our local community and program. And it affects most of the pillars of community health and wellness, whether that's academic equity through our school-based mentoring, employment and post-secondary equity and representation through our Beyond School Walls school-to-work mentoring, or community neighborhood connectedness through our community-based mentoring and our Bigs and Badges program. So I'd love to tell you just a little bit about each of those programs now. With the next slide, community-based is our oldest, longest-running national mentoring program. It's what most people think of when they think of Big Brothers, Big Sisters. It's a trained, screened, trusted adult going to the home of a young person, collecting them, and taking them really outside of their conditions and their environment and giving them opportunity through exposure. Why this is so important is that most of us have about a 5-mile radius that we travel every day. That could be to work, to the grocery store, maybe to your place of worship, to your community center. For our youth, that's really no different, but if you're transportation limited, that circle gets even smaller. So there are members in my local community in Northeast Florida of young people who have never, maybe native to our city, who have never ever seen the ocean and we're an oceanfront town. Or maybe who have never even ridden over a bridge when we're a bridge, a city of bridges. And so this is an incredible opportunity to take young people out of their circumstances and not from a place of judgment, but just expose them to everything Northeast Florida has to offer them. And this happens all across the state of Florida and really just starts to give young people a vision that they can partner in all areas of their community. Next slide. Site-based mentoring is an incredible opportunity to push into a school location or a site location like a Boys and Girls Club, a police athletic league, and it tends to have a little bit more of an academic focus in nature. Now, while mentoring is not what we, I mean, tutoring is not what we do at Big Brothers, we do mentoring, this does tend to have an academic flair because a lot of times we are connecting with young people as an accountability partner. One more champion, maybe in the absence of a parent who might be working, to just check in and say, hey, it's important that you're making good behavior choices at school so you and everyone in your class can learn. Or, hey, have you done that spelling? Let's study for a few minutes before we start playing some basketball together. This is, as an employer, an incredible way that you can encourage your teammates to go out and be in the community in a very contained way. They can do it during the workday in most instances. And if you're a company that gives maybe paid volunteer time, this could be a really great vehicle to do that work. Next slide. We also have a program specifically focused on workforce development. So Beyond School Walls is in its 13th year in Northeast Florida. There are many markets across the state of Florida and the nation who offer this program, but essentially it is a workforce development and talent acquisition strategy for our corporate partners. And it's the opportunity to take high school age students. In my community, we find students who have a desire or passion for a certain industry, and we align them with mentors from that particular industry. They go during the workday. In my community, it's once a month for about 3 hours. They receive industry related training or employability, soft skill development, job shadowing, and then mentorship time over lunch with their designated mentor. Our program lasts about 2 years. And typically what happens is these young people are given first opportunity for apprenticeship programs, internships that these companies offer. And now, because we're 13 years in, we're starting to see some of these young people actually come back and get employed. And I think what is most powerful about this, as especially as we're thinking of the corporate community in Florida, a lot of times the youth in our state, in my town, your town, will say, especially if they're economically disadvantaged and they only know what they know, they'll say, I can't wait to graduate because I'm going to get out of this city and I'm going to go to Atlanta or New York. And when you sit down with them and you really dive into what it is that's motivating that behavior or that desire, a lot of them assume there's no opportunity for them in their local community. There's nothing that that place has to offer that could take them to where they think they want to go. And by programs like Beyond School Walls, where we're able to connect them with corporations that could inspire career employment, not just minimum wage shift, you know, packing them together, but career employment, where people want you to come work for them for 20, 30 years. They want to pay you well. They want to keep you trained and educated. They care about your mental health and your benefits. And they want to make sure you're existing in a culture that gives back to the community. We're shifting the message for the youth of our community, especially our youth that maybe don't always hear it, that have historically been marginalized, that you have talent to bring to our community. And we want to identify it. We want to nurture that talent. And then we want it to stay right here in our Florida community so that Florida continues to be the best state in the United Nations. Next slide. Bigs and Badges is also an incredible program that we offer, especially in the realm of safety. This program locally we've been doing since 2017, but creates an opportunity for servicemen and women, law enforcement, first responders, really anyone seen in a uniform as an authority figure, to have the opportunity to have a positive interaction with youth. Most of the youth, although we serve any child at Big Brothers who needs or wants a big, most of our young people are disadvantaged economically. About 49% of our families report family histories of incarceration or engagement with the justice system. And so that means the youth in the household, even if a law enforcement officer is coming in to remove them because maybe there's domestic violence or a challenge in the home, all they see is that this law enforcement person came and took my loved one away, right? So it's a negative experience. And so this program really seeks to create opportunity for positive association, positive experiences with law enforcement and first responders in our community so that our young people can experience a trusting relationship. And so that our officers and our authority figures also gain empathy and understanding on both sides and can maybe adjust their tactics and their approach based on those learnings and that change in perspective. And on the next slide, all of these programs are significant. We also recognize, just as many other nonprofits and mentoring organizations, mentoring by itself is not the silver bullet. So we recognize, and that's that mentoring one-to-one plus in that ecosystem I showed, that children do not exist in a vacuum, right? And so we can take them out and show them the world, but at the end of the day, if we bring them home and they don't have food or they don't have electricity to turn the lights on to do homework in the winter, or they don't have internet and all of these basic things that we all probably take for granted in our lives, it is limiting. So we do have an education support specialist, a social worker on staff. We engage heavily with 2-on-1. So I appreciated Melissa's presentation to make sure that we're helping be one more champion to connect our families and our children and sometimes our mentors with much needed resources in the community. Great example of that, when COVID hit and the world went digital, most of our families did not have hardware, but they didn't have software and connectivity options in their homes to continue to go virtual when the rest of us did. So we engaged our corporate community, we engaged our partners. We were able to source 450 laptops to give out to the youth in our program, connected them with free internet to a corporate partner, and were able to help those families continue to have connection to not only their places of employment and their school, maybe their places of worship, their healthcare providers. And those are all, you know, hypercritical things that make sure everybody is getting that sense of safety. Go to the next slide. And then click through one more time for me. And so what this really focuses, again, when we work on that one-to-one plus and we're considering a young person at the center of an ecosystem and addressing all of those ecosystems and ways that we can build safety and security around the young person, we start to get incredible outcomes. So that's that post-secondary choices start to open up, that social, emotional health and well-being, inclusion and belonging are all components that start to come along. If you go to the next slide. We see additional impacts of mentoring coming through. And so here's some of the outcomes that youth from a deficiency standpoint, they're less likely to act out physically, less likely to make poor behavior choices like starting illegal substances, skipping school, lying, some of those things that are predicative behavior to leading into justice engagement. And from a strength-based standpoint, our young people are more confident in their schoolwork. 99% of young people who are mentored say they feel valued and listened to. So that makes them more likely to engage in leadership roles, more likely to graduate and enter adulthood with career choices informed by increased social capital that their mentor often brings. And that all has a ripple effect in how they're engaging in their communities and how they're engaging in their families. And making sure that that experience of self-fulfillment and belonging blooms out to the rest of the community. We go to the next. We are all psychologically wired to connect. And so other components of the effects of mentoring really start to illustrate that. And not only do we know that young people are doing better in school and they develop these cognitive skills, they reduce those risky behaviors, but now we're actually also starting to see that not only is mentoring good for a young person, it actually can physically combat and heal the brain from trauma or from negative experiences. And that is something that can happen in the adolescent years through research with our partners at Changing Minds. We're really starting to see that more and more. So when you have a global experience like a pandemic and you have other challenges like hurricanes that hit our community or other things like that, that cause these adverse childhood experiences, having one more trusted adult is really the opportunity to not only heal that young person from an emotional standpoint, but actually to rewire some of the physiological wellness of the person, developing that trust and that connection, that relationship that actually can have lifelong impacts on their lifelong wealth and health and wellness. And when that opportunity to connect and grow and help youth reach their full potential, ultimately we get more of this. So slide. We get more of our young people walking across the graduation stage with a clear path to their most promising future and connections that honestly, although we ask for a year of Big Brothers, Big Sisters, often last a lifetime for these young people in our community. And these are then young people that have the opportunity to go get employment within our community, to go be community leaders, to become community trustees for the community and give back in any way that they can. If you go on to the next slide. I think it's so important to note, it just takes one. A lot of times you can come to these types of webinars and see the challenges are so great, noting 1 in 3 young people will grow up without a mentor. But really it just takes one person to be a value add to that young person to help put their life on a whole different trajectory. And so that's why mentoring informs safety and security for the young people in our community and our community as a whole. And so my contact's on the next slide, but I know Kyle, you all may have some thoughts or reactions to some of that presentation.
Hey, Sarah, that was a phenomenal presentation. Thank you so much for sharing with us the work of Big Brothers and Big Sisters. I wanted to speak with you quickly about the multi-generational impacts for families when youth are mentored. Could you touch on that a bit more?
Absolutely. So as I mentioned, although we're really interacting with a young person and tethering them to a mentor in the community, we recognize that young person is part of a whole ecosystem and a structure. And so when we do our child safety checks, because we professionally support and manage all of our mentoring relationships, and we check in on that family, that caregiver, we can get a sense, you know, is there something else going on in the home? Maybe we need to advocate and inform them about 2-on-1. Maybe we need to link them with another partner that can help in a crisis situation. And in some cases, we've also been able to create these college fairs and multi-generational roundtables where we bring in partners like CareerSource of Northeast Florida to actually give even some of our caregivers opportunity to expand their employment skills and to get more gainfully employed as well. So we really take, we call it mentoring one-to-one plus, because we really focus on the whole ecosystem the child's existing in.
And early on in your presentation, you also discussed the importance of exposure even outside of the 5-mile radius. And I think that's really important, especially with some of my personal life experiences. I had a really great upbringing. My parents did the most for my sister and I. But I remember the opportunities where I spent time at our teen center that they built here in Tallahassee, because they wanted an opportunity for us teens to just literally be teens. And some of my counterparts didn't have that opportunity, where they didn't have to, where they didn't always have to be the sole provider of their family, you know? So I wanted to talk about the work that you all are doing to ensure students get those opportunities even outside of their everyday community and neighborhood and resources.
Yeah, I love that. Well, and I think what is true and so true about the human existence is that we know what we know and we don't know what we don't know, right? And this is true of people, it's true of places, it's true of professions. And so exposure just creates opportunity for young people to start to learn more and to have a vision, right? But the exposure that happens with Big Brothers, Big Sisters is not one-sided. It creates opportunity for everyone engaged in the experience, from our staff to our mentors, the guardians, the youth, to get a new perspective on how other people in our community might be existing or living. We get a different and deeper appreciation for the gifts that we have and the opportunity. In Beyond School Walls in particular, opportunity through exposure is huge. If you take high school students and you say, okay, at, you know, our Jacksonville Transportation Authority, who works there? They probably just say the bus drivers. But we know that every company, every industry has so much more. And so a great example of that is we used to take medical magnet students to the Mayo Clinic here in Jacksonville for mentorship. And there was a young student, she loved everything medical. It was a passion. You could see her light up when she talked about it, but she was never going to save your life. She didn't want to touch the blood. It was not for her. And she thought only doctors and nurses existed in the medical field. So we got to go back to the Mayo Clinic and we noticed she was really artistically inclined. So we went back and asked if they had a medical photographer or a medical illustrator that could potentially be her mentor. And they said, of course, we're a teaching hospital. That's critical to how we capture our learnings and move them forward for journaling and all these kinds of things. So that medical illustrator got recruited to be her mentor. And the day that young person realized she could be in an industry she had a passion for, but use her own skills and talents and aptitudes to move that industry forward, was like lightning caught fire to this young person. And that is the vision of what happens when you create exposure, right? It's giving young people and all people the idea that you belong in every part of our community and there's a role for you. We just have to find the right seat. And if you can find something you're passionate about and that's situated with your skills to the best of our ability, then you thrive. We all know that flow state when we get there, we can tell that we're doing great work. And that's when we can get to that true self-actualization and when we're ready to also then get back to our community in a whole host of ways.
And when it comes to your programs like Beyond School Walls and your other initiatives like the Bigs and Badges, I believe that's what it's called, how is the voice of the community utilized or the youth engaged? Like, do you all ask them what they like to see? Is it based off of surveys? Like, could you go into some more detail about that?
Yeah, I can. And it's all of those things. So I think what is really special and different about Big Brothers, Big Sisters in particular compared to some of the other providers, everything we do is tailored to the individual that we're engaging. So the mentoring relationship, community-based is a structure, but every single relationship looks unique and different based on what that family particularly needs or wants, what that mentor is prepared to provide. That's true for our corporate partnerships too. So we have 16 Beyond School Walls partners. We have six more launching this year. Not a single one looks the same because we're tailoring it to that specific industry. A lot of times our industry partners come to the table and they're starting to shape what our schools are teaching because they're like, no, this is what our current industry needs, not those textbooks from 20 years ago. Here's the trends that we need. Here's the employment standard we need young people to be graduating high school with and prepared to do. So it's really a combination of all those things. And then of course, making sure I'm minding things like our chamber, like our United Way, like the Florida Chamber, and watching for those trends that are in the community so we can uniquely start to position our organization in Northeast Florida and the many other markets across the state of Florida to uniquely move forward the needs and address the needs that our local community has. So in Northeast Florida, we're one of the top five growing cities economically. We have so many companies coming here and our corporate partners are saying, we need workers, we need talent development programs, we need it now. And so we have over the course of the last 13 years, really pivoted a lot of our portfolio to be about the Beyond School Walls school to work model, because that's what our community is telling us they need.
Well, that's amazing, Sarah. Thank you so much for your willingness to participate in today's webinar. Throughout your presentation, the phrase, it takes a village, was just constantly going through my mind. And Big Bros, Big Sisters is just another example of that. It truly does take a village, especially when moving the needle in our communities.
Absolutely does. Thank you for that.
Well, if we go to the next slide, we did want to end today's webinar off with thanking our Equality of Opportunity Initiative Advisory Board members. Without their leadership and investment into our work, we wouldn't be able to have these type of webinars and keep you all updated the way that we do. On the next slide, we hope that you continue to join our movement, and we hope to see you at our 2023 Florida Chamber Annual Meeting and Future of Florida Forum happening October 23rd and 24th at the Hyatt Regency Grand Cypress in Orlando, Florida. Look at the end, look for our email. We'll have additional follow-up information and additional information regarding our next upcoming webinar. And thank you all so much for joining us today, and we look forward to seeing you next month.